good evening, and welcome to Bloomberg. May I ask, just on a show of hands, how many of you, is this the first time at Bloomberg? Wonderful. I hope the experience has caught you off guard, and I hope that you enjoy your time here. And check out the sixth floor before you leave, because it is absolutely stunning on every level. My name is Keith Grossman. I am the Global Chief Revenue Officer of Bloomberg Media. This is an incredible honor for me to be able to introduce tonight's event of Cornell Tech at Bloomberg. I am a Cornell alum myself. Do you mind me asking, in the room, Cornell alums? Awesome. Are there any Stanford alums? Okay, good, because I'm going to tell a story that's totally offensive towards Stanford. but the reason that this is important to me is not because we just have an incredible speaker and interviewee with John Martin, chairman and CEO of Turner, and Scarlett Fu of Bloomberg TV, but to me personally, I have been at Bloomberg for 3 years now. And prior to Bloomberg, I was at Condé Nast, I was at Wired, and I was contacted by Dean Dan Hutenlocher. And if you know him, it's the dean of the Cornell Tech campus. And when he sent me an email, I thought he was just asking for money. And at first I said, you know, no, I'm not interested in this email. But then I sat down with him, and he told me what Cornell's ambitions were, to come to New York, that there was a exhibition that the mayor at the time, Mike Bloomberg, was putting on. To have a tech campus and to really create a tech hub in New York City. And he wanted me, because I was a Cornell alum within the tech space at Wired and Ars Technica, to get my perspective on what it would be like. And so I went to an evening with them and I said to them, what's your strategy? And they said, we have great teachers and we have great curriculum. And I said, well, how are we gonna beat Stanford? Because if you remember, before Cornell Tech won, Stanford was the forerunner. Like, everyone thought that Stanford was gonna win this. And he said, we have no strategy versus Stanford, we're just gonna win on merit. And being in the media, I said, there's no way that we could win on merit, right? Like, we have to actually just like jam it down their throat and constantly win. And I got so angry at this meeting, and I went home and I was with my best friend. And I went home and I looked at Cornell's Twitter handle. And Cornell's Twitter handle, if you knew what it was a NY Tech Campus. And I was like, oh, these guys don't know anything about branding or marketing. This is killing me. And so at 3 a.m, I registered the Twitter handle Cornell Tech NYC. And I figured it was the most duh-duh obvious Twitter handle you could possibly get. I see you shaking your head, right? It is so obvious, right? So we registered this Twitter handle, and my best friend and I were just bored. We needed a hobby, and we're traveling around the country, and I'm in between meetings, and we figured we put in parameters that we were only going to tweet out really interesting facts about Cornell that were positive. There was never gonna be anything negative. But since we all knew that there was a divide at Stanford between Hennessy, their dean, and who wanted to have this campus, and the students who thought it was so offensive to be on the East Coast, every time the Stanford Daily wrote something negative about this tech campus, we made sure the whole world saw it, right? So we just retweeted, right? And so we would constantly bait Stanford, and we kept on baiting Stanford, and they kept on falling for it. And the following on the Twitter handle kept on getting bigger and bigger, and we hit 100 people within a day, and then 200 people, and then like 3,000 people. And then I got a call from a guy named Danny Stein and Gus Warren, and they said, you guys are doing a great job. We actually had de Blasio following us and all of the mayoral candidates following us in this, and they said, you're doing such a great job, but you need more scale. What can we do? And we chose to do an online petition. So if anyone signed the online petition, and there were 21,000 signatures, ultimately, that's what we did. But what we decided we were gonna do was we weren't gonna just choose any online petition. We figured we'd really taunt Stanford. And so we chose change.org, which, if you know anything about Stanford, they developed. And so we thought it would be like a funny way to sort of taunt them and do this. And the petition just kept on going on. And at Cornell, it was so interesting to see the divide, because they had never actually taken a media stance before. And I said to Dan Hutenlocher, I said, I want to give you this Twitter handle because I'm getting worried about it. And he said, no, no, no. He goes, if I take it, then it falls into the Cornell sort of bureaucracy. But if you take it, you could do whatever you want outside of the Cornell bureaucracy, which is, I mean, it was an admirable thing to say, but it was kind of a weird position to be in, because I all of a sudden felt like I was empowered to do anything, in that regard, including I called up one person who I knew had a listserv of, I think, 500 people, and they put the petition out to the listserv. Cornell's lawyers got really upset about this, and so Cornell's lawyers told me, they sent me a letter for a cease and desist, and they said, stop doing this, stop spamming our listservs. And I said, no, and they said, we'll sue you. And I said, I'm trying to help you. And they said, stop it. And I said, if you don't stop harassing me, I'm going to publish your letter on the Cornell Tech NYC Twitter handle, which is weird because everyone thinks that I'm you. And so I told Dan Hutenlocker this, and Dan Hutenlocker, this is fascinating, Dan Hutenlocker tells President Skorton. And so then President Skorton's like, this is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. And so he tells the lawyers, back off, and then he tells the head of all of communications to open up the entire listserv of every Cornell alumni in the country to our email, to our survey. And so we put it out, and we got, it was amazing, we got 21,000 signatures in support of Cornell Tech. And just so you know, it's totally coincidental that I'm at Bloomberg today, I swear to God. Totally coincidental. I was at Wired at the time. We get 21,000. I took the signatures to Staples and I printed them out. And 21,000 signatures on 8-point font was about this thick. It cost me, I paid it out of my own pocket, $465, okay? It was unbelievable. And we overnighted it to Bloomberg, to Bob Steele, to Seth Pinsky, to anyone who we knew was influential. And then we just prayed. And we literally just wanted this campus to win. And then when we won, it was the best feeling ever. And for me, to now be at Bloomberg and to now be able to open up a night like this is just, it's so unbelievably meaningful. And so I can't thank you guys enough for joining us this evening. This is an incredible institution that we are supporting. And Scarlett is an incredible anchor on Bloomberg Television. And please, I will kick it over to you to set off the night.
Thank you so much, Keith.
That's a tough act to follow.
I know.
I went to the University of Pennsylvania in Columbia, so I don't know anything about Cornell and Stanford.
Well, we're here with John Martin. He is chairman and CEO of Turner. And as you mentioned, you went to Wharton, and you went to Columbia to get your MBA. So your background is in finance, right? Mm-hmm. You're a finance guy at heart. You were investor relations. You were the CFO at Time Warner, Time Warner Cable before that. And then you made this transition to media. So that's a lot of years working with investors, focusing on the numbers. What do you think has been the hardest part of the transition to content and distribution?
Not focusing on the numbers? No.
There's still lots of numbers.
I've grown up in the Time Warner family. I've been at the company for almost 25 years. And, you know, people think if you're in finance, you're just sitting there reading spreadsheets. But the fact of the matter is I've been involved in the company's strategy for at least 15 years. And as the CFO of the company, really a junior partner to Jeff Bukas, who's the chairman and CEO. And Jeff is always kind enough to include me in all of the strategic decisions. So it was actually a reasonably natural transition to go to Turner, although it's been incredibly exciting to join at a time, and I've been the CEO of Turner since the beginning of 2014. There has never been a more challenging time to be in the media business, but there's also never been a more intellectually interesting time to be in the media business. So I feel like I'm in the middle of a storm, but at the same time, like I've never been more excited to be part of it.
Absolutely. And you talk about how you were exposed to this strategy from the get-go because you've been at Time Warner for a while now. With the rise of digital, with the dominance of Netflix, all of that has eroded traditional television's share. Part of your response to that is to reinvent Turner from the inside out. Mm-hmm. Tell us what that means, and tell us what that means in terms of the kinds of investments you're making.
Sure. And at the risk of repeating what you just said, that is the ambition that we have at Turner, is nothing short of a complete reinvention of the company from the inside out. So that means we are transforming the company from being a traditional ad-supported basic cable network company that really cared about getting reach and maximizing viewership to all of a sudden the metrics that are really gonna matter in the future is fan engagement. We need fans, mm-hmm. not just viewers. And at the hub or underscoring that sensibility is technology. So when I joined the company in the beginning of 2014, in the United States alone, we had 29 content management systems. None of them spoke to one another. Mm-hmm. None of them had really any data in them to speak of. And over the past almost three and a half years, I'm really proud to say we're in the midst of a very, very significant technology transformation where we're moving our traditional broadcast TV up to the cloud, our content libraries, our applications are going up to the cloud, and technology is literally something where we have dramatically increased our capabilities, and it's going to be at the centerpiece of how we reach our fans in new and different and innovative ways, because we can't think of ourselves as just a TV network company anymore. We're a fan engagement company. So wherever our fans are, whether on the mobile phones or iPads, and whether they're in South Korea or in London or in Dallas, we need to be able to reach them in a seamless way. And so that's been a very, very fun part of the job, which is to really make significant investments in technology to support everything else that we're doing in terms of creating premium content.
So you've been doing this for a couple of years now, this effort to turn Turner inside out. Where are you in the process? So would you say that you're in the
second work in
inning,
progress.
The eighth inning? Give us something specific.
I'd say we're in the fourth inning.
Fourth inning.
Yeah, no, I'm really proud of what we've been able to do. We centralized all of our technology operations into one organization. We've made meaningful investments. We are looking to honestly lead the industry. Mm-hmm. And this whole notion of personalized content, which I think the whole industry is barely scratching the surface of, but we're doing things like, imagine in your household, do you have any kids?
I have two.
Okay, so good. This, we didn't practice this ahead of time. But, and hopefully they're, I don't, how old are they?
11 and 13.
Okay. So are they Cartoon Network watchers?
Of
course. Please don't say no. Okay. All right. So, but imagine if they're watching Cartoon Network and they're watching the live, what we call the linear stream, the feed, we will shortly have the ability to serve up different Cartoon Network experiences to your children based on their preferences. This whole idea of personalized networking, which I don't think people are really thinking about right now, but it's going to completely transform the way that people enjoy media.
So it takes on-demand to a whole new level, essentially. It
takes on-demand to a whole new level. Imagine, I mean, how many people use Spotify? We want to create, Jesus. It's a lot. We want to make our video sort of like Spotify, in the sense that people can create their own content list. They can archive it, put it in libraries, access it whenever they want to, wherever they want to. And then at the same time, if they don't want to do it on an on-demand basis, we can serve different live linear streams to them at the same time. In fact, we made a very significant investment in 2015 in a company called iStream Planet, and led by Mio Babic, who's a brilliant entrepreneur and technologist. And I'm not just saying that because he's sitting in the almost front row here, but Mio's still leading the company. But iStream Planet is arguably the country's leading distributor of live IP streaming. And Mio's done events like the Olympics and the World Cup. And to be able to carry live video streaming at huge scale, where increasingly, and this is going to be an important concept that we're going to keep coming back to over and over again, media companies are going to have to increasingly own end-to-end the consumer relationship. Because for years, there was always an argument in media. Is content king or is distribution king? Well, I would argue now that neither of those are actually correct. There's a third leg to the stool, which is the consumer experience is just as important as the other two. And I think Netflix showed us that, because I would argue Netflix doesn't have the best content available in the world, but because it's easy to use, available, it works, it's intuitive, it's got great parental controls, it's got enough content, that's why they're, and it's offered at a really good value, it's a fantastic product. We've got to evolve our business in a way where we can be that, and at the same time work with our traditional wholesale retail partners, rather, who pay us about $5.5 billion a year.
Okay, so you talk about your fans, that's one customer, but what does it mean for your other customer, which is the cable providers? Won't they be mad? Won't they be upset that you are in pursuing the direct engagement with consumers and maybe even one day offering them something directly that they'll be cut out?
I don't think cut out. We actually are working with them in many respects. I mean, we would like to do nothing more than to partner with them and use them as a retail distributor, as a marketer for us. We just launched two new over-the-top services, or what's called over-the-top, which is direct-to-consumer. We launched a product called Filmstruck, which is a complement product to Turner Classic Movies. It's a video, it's a film library product for video movie enthusiasts. And we just launched another product called Boomerang, which is will eventually have probably 4,000 episodes of classic and iconic programming from both Cartoon Network and Warner Brothers. And we would love to be able to go to our traditional cable satellite telco partners and say, work with us, be distributors of this product. We'll cut you in on the economics, and then we can kind of ride on their back, so to speak, as they offer it in all of their call centers, which is because those businesses are massively transactional. And if they choose not to do that, then that's fine. We could just go direct to consumer ourselves, which is what we're doing. But I think, you know, this whole, look, it's an understatement that the whole distribution landscape is changing, right? I mean, you've got new players coming in, you've got SVOD players, you've got virtual players that are being called virtual MVPDs. So the distributors are not gonna have a choice but to lean into this and try to figure out how they're gonna carve out their space if they're gonna remain relevant in the future.
And of course, AT&T is in the process of trying to buy Time Warner.
I haven't heard that.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, it's not official yet.
Is that a secret?
That might be one reason why. It hasn't been approved, right? And we're still waiting for approval, government approval of that. How does that purchase fit in with your strategy?
I think it fits in perfectly, honestly, because as I was mentioning about technology, we've been moving as quickly as we can. We started, honestly, 3.5 years ago from sort of a standing start. And we've made a tremendous amount of progress, and I'm really proud of the technology team and all of our employees at Turner in terms of where we are now. But if you think about just in terms of sheer scale of what AT&T, the assets that they have, if you think about the tech platform that they have, the data, which increasingly is going to transform not only how we monetize audiences, how we market our products and services, and then even eventually how we create content in and of itself. And they have, they own DirecTV, which has 25 million customer relationships in the United States. And then they have 130 million mobile relationships. So that provides an incredible landscape for us to work collaboratively to try to innovate together, create new products. It gets us to our tech ambitions much faster than we otherwise could have done on our own. And I think the winner in all of this is going to be the consumer, because I think they're going to continue to get better and better products, and advertisers are going to continue to benefit because we'll be much smarter about who is actually consuming the video content that we're offering up.
So talent and personnel will be key in executing this vision that you have. Give us a sense of what jobs will look like at Turner in 5 years' time or in 10 years' time.
It's going to look fantastic.
What kind of people will be hired? Are we talking about the traditional creative types, or?
Well, we're always going to need creative. I mean, we're a premium content company. So if we don't continue to create great stories, whether that's on the CNN side through just our live coverage of news, or whether it's through Cartoon Network's creation of kids animation, or does anybody watch Adult Swim?
There we go.
We got a few people. You got some crazy animation and live action shows on Adult Swim, which has been the number one network delivering adults 18 to 34 for 12 years in a row. But we have the number one network, the number five network, three of the top 10, four of the top 20. We're the only company that has that. We have to keep investing in premium content. We've got sports that matter, which are locked in through beyond 2020. So we're going to continue to want the very best storytellers and creatives. But at the same time, I would like Turner to be known more and more as a company that is attracting the best and the brightest technologists.
What does that mean? What kind of technologists would find a job at Turner in 5 years' time? We have a lot of Cornell Tech students in the audience. We have a lot of Columbia Business School students in the audience. Give us a sense of what you'd be looking for, what you're looking for now.
Well, what we're looking for are people that actually can bring product experience. I mean, we need, if you look at, for example, CNN, CNN's digital business is a very, very big business. It's hundreds of millions of dollars of revenue. And in 5 years, we'll probably contribute more to CNN's profit than the linear TV network. We need CNN's digital products to be the best in the world. We need Bleacher Report, its products to be the best in the world. We need to have a world-class network that, as I mentioned before, from a consumer experience, to make sure that we can deliver from the time when we encode and upload our video to the time when we deliver to the distribution consumer electronics device, a seamless experience that always works and is world-class and is fantastic. And, you know, one of the reasons why I think it's a difficult question to answer is I don't even know in 5 and 10 years what the technology jobs are going to look like, because my sense is we're probably going to invent a few businesses between now and then that could completely transform what the complexion of the company is.
All right, well, right now we know that there are a lot of skinny bundles on offer. More are probably going to come as well. So if you put your finance hat back on, have you seen any impact on Turner's revenue from the advent of these skinny bundles?
No, I think it's a good thing, actually, because...
None whatsoever?
No, it's been positive. Because we have deals with Sling, with Sony View. We have announced a deal with Hulu. They're expecting to launch, I think, sometime later this year. We're in very constructive discussions with a number of other big scale players who have ambitions to enter the space. And so we have seen a slow decline in multi-channel TV subscribers in the United States. And in my view, part of the reason why that is because it's just too damn expensive. And there are too many networks in the United States. A bunch of them have to disappear. So almost 90% or 85% of the nearly $5 billion in distribution revenue that we get are only in four networks: TBS, TNT, CNN, and Cartoon Network. Those are leading networks. So our goal is to get those networks in as many packages as possible. And so I believe the virtual MVPDs are now approaching 2 million subscribers in the US. A bunch of those, I don't know how many exactly, but a bunch of those subscribers are so-called cord cutters, or people that otherwise dropped out of the population because they didn't want to pay $80 to get 500 channels when they didn't watch 480 of them. So I think we've got the most highly concentrated portfolio of must-have networks in the country. And that gives me confidence that we're going to be fine. I think the skinny bundles net-net are going to be a positive.
So you mentioned CNN, obviously one of the more in-demand networks that are out there for consumers who want to invest in these skinny bundles. What's your biggest challenge in sustaining the recent success of the network? I mean, this comes despite the President of the United States calling CNN fake news, denouncing your talent. How do you sustain the success that you have had?
Look, I think, first of all, I give huge compliments to Jeff Zucker and the leadership team at CNN. CNN has never been stronger financially and editorially. And I believe if you look at the linear TV ratings in the United States, all news organizations are up. Like the human curiosity of news now that has been sparked by the presidential election, the first 100 days of the new administration, and unfortunately, but all the crazy things that are going on around the world right now, as evidenced by what happened in Paris today. And the leader of North Korea saying that he's gonna basically bring the military operations of the United States to ashes. We are in an environment where there is going to continue to be 24/7 news cycles, to the extent that I think we've never seen before. And I actually think companies like yours and companies like CNN, the journalistic mission has never been more important. So this idea of fake news, I think, is good for CNN. And it's good for companies like Bloomberg, because more and more, I think, people are going to be searching for those sources of news that they can actually trust. And so if you just look at the audiences that we're reaching at CNN, so in the United States, on the live television network, the average age of viewers is 58 years old. I think Fox News is 67. So we were 62 a few years ago, 67 and getting older. 58 today. If you look at the average age on CNN.com, I believe it's 48. If you look at the average age on the CNN app, it's 38. And if you look at the average age on CNN Snapchat, it's 27. So we are reaching people across all of the various platforms, and I think that's fantastic. Like, my daughter's 19 years old. She would never watch CNN, the channel, but the two things that she goes to in the morning is Instagram and Snapchat to watch her CNN news.
So you're reaching her to another media.
Exactly, exactly. So this whole thing about fake news, you know, I don't subscribe to that. I mean, we're not in the fake news business. And look, some of what CNN does is, by reporting objectively, is sometimes we report things that people don't want to hear. Mm-hmm. But I'm very proud of the editorial quality and the journalistic mission that we have and the seriousness with which the team takes it.
Well, fake news, of course, is all in the eye of the beholder.
Exactly.
And you mentioned Fox News. We've seen how quickly...
You think they're fake news? No, I'm asking. I'm turning the interview on you.
I have my moments where I wonder. Let's put it like that. We've seen how quickly Bill O'Reilly has well, not risen, but has fallen at Fox News. And we've seen that advertisers really helped push that along. There's a speed at which they move that was unthinkable maybe a year ago or 2 years ago. So the money that you're getting from advertisers, how confident are you that it's sticky, that it'll be with you? The minute that there's some interpretation of news that doesn't agree with someone, they could bolt.
But that's like that in all of our businesses. I mean, I don't
but
think
But you have social media compounding it now.
Yeah, I think so. I actually, and look, I'm not going to comment specifically on the O'Reilly situation, and I'm not, I have no familiarity with what's happening with the advertising environment there. But I think the idea of advertisers moving more quickly to put their messages against brands that they feel comfortable with, I actually think that's a good thing. And we all have to hold ourselves accountable in the media to put out, whether it's in news or any of the entertainment, sports, kids, any of our genres, we have to be held accountable for what we do each and every day. And so if we reach consumers and fans in a way that we want to, I think the advertisers will be with us. If we screw up, I think we have to be prepared to have a financial effect to that.
Mm-hmm. One thing you've noted is that there's money coming back to TV from some of the digital outlets. Mm-hmm. It's made a meaningful return. What do you think was a catalyst for that? Was there a specific tipping point that caused that?
I think there's, and look, you know, digital is still growing quickly. I mean, our digital businesses, whether it's CNN or Bleacher Report, they have some of the strongest growth rates in advertising across our company. So, but there's definitely a fight for share. And let's face it, in the digital world, it's almost an oligopoly, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, nearly two-thirds of all digital ad dollars are going to two companies, Facebook and Google, and they're probably taking 85% of the growth in digital. And I think what's been called into question somewhat a little bit is the efficacy of the metrics with which they've been selling advertising against. But what's really happening here is there's an arms race going on, and it's almost a race to the middle. If you're a company like ours, a premium content company, we're trying to develop the digital capabilities that we can go to advertisers and guarantee them audiences and return on investment and really be able to report out in a specific way to make sure that they're comfortable that their marketing messages are reaching the consumers that they thought they were going to. And that gets back to the technology investments that we've been making and the impact that data is going to have in really revolutionizing the way that we're going to be able to monetize those audiences. On the flip side, the big digital companies are doing the exact opposite, which is they're trying to get into premium content, whether that's YouTube or whether it's Facebook. And we're calling it internally at Time Warner and Turner, it's a race to the center. Mm. Who's going to get there faster? Can TV pick up the best of what has made digital distinctive and different and in the eyes of advertisers a really terrific buy versus, you know, can the digital players get their hands on enough premium content that they can convince the advertisers to continue to go in their direction? Look, there's going to be plenty of money to go around everywhere, but I like the chances of TV with the reach that we have, the brand-friendly environment, and the immersive, incredible emotional connection that we have to storytelling.
And the scale is what the advertisers like as well. One thing, though, that can be frustrating for any TV viewer, if you're watching linear TV, the commercials are long, they're boring. Even when you're watching it on demand, you can't get past it quickly enough. You can't even fast forward through them anymore. How do you address that?
We're going to reduce the number of commercials per hour.
Really?
Yes. So this is the challenge. It's the challenge and the opportunity. Because I agree with you. Again, why has Netflix risen so much in terms of popularity? And why has Hulu risen so much?
You can binge
watch. Because there's too much advertising clutter on traditional television. Mm-hmm. So we have announced on one of our networks, True TV, we've already taken a commercial ad load down in half. And we started that in the fourth quarter of last year. We've been revenue neutral to up so far. So you may ask yourself, well, how is that possible? We've also reduced the commercial loads on a number of our original programs on TBS and TNT.
Are you doing more programming? How are you feeling?
So we're making our programming longer. Mm-hmm. And so the way that we think we can make up for the reduced ad loads is we got to make the advertising better, more contextually relevant. We believe that our ratings are actually higher as a result of having reduced ad loads. In other words, if you looked at minute-by-minute ratings on traditional ad-supported cable, commercial starts, ratings go down, and then when the commercial ad pot is done, you hope that the ratings come back to where they were when you went into the ad pot. Well, if you have fewer commercials, you have higher engagement, higher average audience levels, and your ratings go up. We've also done some research that seems to indicate that if you make your advertisements more relevant and contextual, and I'll come back to that in a second, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. And you reduce the number of them, recall of the ads go up at least 10%. So you have higher ratings, higher recall, and then if anybody watched like basketball, March Madness? Anybody? Okay, a few people. You all tune into sports more. We were putting on advertisements during the March Madness basketball tournament that had Charles Barkley in them, Samuel Jackson, Spike Lee. These were engaging, funny advertisements. And
as premium content.
As premium content in its own right. And so we now have studios internally at Turner where we're producing our own advertising.
What kind of investment does that take?
It costs a little dough, but we're a big company. We're all right.
What you're describing sounds like a Super Bowl ad where people stick around to
it's
watch
like
the
12
ads.
12 months of Super Bowl ads, basically.
12 months of Super Bowl ads.
Well, that's what it's going to have to, because ad-supported television is not going to be able to sustain if you continue to interrupt the television shows with, you know, very quick spots and dots commercials. There's been so much innovation in distribution, in programming, and there has not been a lot of innovation in advertising. And I think over the next 5 years, there'll be as much or more innovation in advertising than any of the other areas of the business.
Do you see your competitors responding and doing something similar?
Yeah, and we want them to, because this is a perfect example of, I think, the rising tide can lift all boats. Marketers and agency executives are saying, because everybody now, you know, the buzzword is data. We have data. Mm-hmm. Come, buy off of our data. Well, they have to go, Time Warner has its data, and Viacom has its data, and NBC has its data, and they're looking up and they're saying, can't we standardize this thing? It would be much easier if we could buy off of one set of data that we can trust, mm-hmm, and that we can standardize. And so we just collectively made an announcement last week, us, Viacom, and Fox. It's a consortium called OpenAP, maybe not the best branded name, but...
You need a better name.
But it's essentially meant to begin to standardize the way marketers and agencies can buy audiences, mm-hmm, based on data that they can trust. Mm-hmm. And so we invite other companies to come join. It would be good for the industry. We want to compete on our product and our sales capabilities. We don't want to compete on, we have proprietary data that no one else has. I think that's a losing proposition.
All right, speaking of spending money, and you mentioned sports earlier, Turner has done very well with March Madness.
Thank you.
Clearly, that partnership with CBS works well.
Great.
It's kind of a win-win situation, which is rare.
It's almost unheard of.
Unheard of
true.
In the world of airing big sports events. You've also added esports on, mm-hmm, TBS as well. Talk about what the next step is in Turner's investment in esports. Would you consider sponsoring an individual player, a team? Is that in the cards?
I think, we're looking at the esports strategy right now. We have been looking at it. I think I'm really proud of our sports team. And for anybody that doesn't, I'm assuming everybody knows what esports was. The first time someone within Turner came to me and said, we'd like to make an investment in esports, I'm like, I don't even know what that is. And then I have a 10-year-old son, and he spends more time watching professional gamers play than he does playing video games himself. And unfortunately, it's cutting into the amount of time he's watching Cartoon Network.
Mm.
So all of a sudden,
conflict of interest.
I know. And like, he's this Minecraft kid. So he's watching this guy like Stampy Longnose, who's got one of the most annoying voices I've ever heard. He's like, hello, it's Stampy.
It's his calling card.
And I hear my son like laughing and laughing. And I said to him, I said, so is Stampy like one of the best Minecraft players in the world? He goes, no, Dad, he's average, but he's funny. Mm. So I all of a sudden then, it's like it clicked to me. I said, this is like a television show for him. This is content for him. It just happens to be about a game that he likes to play. So once I sort of understood that, we all got together, we moved quickly, we partnered with WMEIMG, we created E-League. Mm-hmm. We've hosted now two tournaments, including one major. We've got a 10,000-foot production facility down in Atlanta. And this is an area that is just exploding, and it's exploding globally. Arenas are getting sold out. Others are trying to look to start up leagues. I think there's going to be a massive amount of dollar investment that goes into this space, and we are actively trying to figure out the best way that we can be in the midst of that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of that is done live, right? Your son would go to an arena to watch someone play their games, and it's shown on the big screen.
Yeah, I went to the initial, I went to the first ever esports event.
Tournament?
At Turner, it was part of a tournament, and I'm sitting in the back, and there's like a mosh pit of gamers in the front, and it was a first-person shooter game, and I have to admit, and this is, I'm embarrassed to say this, I didn't know what the hell was going on in this game. It was moving so quickly, and we had announcers and everything, but the only time I knew something exciting happened is when the mosh pit of gamers were going nuts, and they knew exactly what was happening. And then we host these events on Twitch, and we were looking at the numbers of people that are watching these events on Twitch, and they are astronomical. And even for TBS, hosting esports events has brought millions of new viewers to TBS at an average age that's significantly younger than the average for a normal TBS program. So I think it's really popular and important programming. And, you know, Turner's always done a great job, and this long predates me. But we're in sports that matter, and we don't want to be in too many more sports. So, you know, esports is an organic way to try to exploit a global secular growth opportunity. But otherwise, we're partners with March Madness, we're partners with the NBA, and we're partners with Major League Baseball.
And golf as well, right?
Yes, we host one golf, a major event.
Okay. We've talked about CNN, we've talked about Turner Sports. In the past, I know we've talked on our own, and you've identified some networks that are challenging when it comes to growth prospects and brand awareness. What are you doing to change that for, say, HLN or True TV? How do you sharpen the focus around that so that they get more fans, there's more engagement?
Right. Well, True TV is actually a burgeoning success story. And I'm really proud of Chris Lynn and the team there. I think True TV now has grown linear ratings for 6 or 7 quarters in a row against a backdrop where not a lot of ad-supported cable networks in the U.S. are growing ratings. And he's doing it through just really fantastic, engaging, and funny programming. And I think we're going to continue to do that. True TV, its challenge is its brand awareness, as you said. I'll never forget, I think I was watching CNBC the first year that March Madness was on, and I knew that they were going to have a few minutes talking about the tournament. I think it was Joe Kernan from CNBC that sort of said, like, what the hell is True TV? And I don't think he was the only person that thought that. But I think, look, we're very committed. I'm really proud that they're growing ratings. They're doing it by really thoughtful branding, really thoughtful programming. HLN similar. HLN is a bit of a challenge because it's an ad-supported network only. We don't get an affiliate fee for HLN. So we're completely, under Ken Jouts' leadership, completely changing out all of the programming. So we have an all-female led on-air talent during the day now between Robin Mead, Erica Hill, Michaela Pereira, and we have Ashley Banfield now on in prime time. And, you know, I mean, they make tens of millions of dollars, but the brands that really matter most to us at Turner are TBS and TNT. So TBS and TNT are two of the four most profitable TV networks in the world.
You mentioned that. So if you've got these four networks that you want to build things around, is there an appetite to shut down some brands perhaps, to exit to slim down, maybe pursue a less is more strategy?
Well, we have, we'll do whatever it takes to be successful in the future, but we have no current plans to do that. Mm. And all of our networks are making money. And as I said, HLN is gonna have its best year financially this year. True TV will have its best year ever financially this year. And we have 10 networks within our portfolio. But as I mentioned, almost 85-90% of our distribution fees are in four. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. I think one of the most important jobs that I have at Turner is to make sure that the company is in a position to be flexible enough to move in any direction necessary to sustain the health of the brands and the business overall. So having only 10, just to put that in perspective, one of our competitors, which I won't name, I'll whisper it after, but they have 14 networks that are below the top 60 mm-hmm. in popularity. So if your network is not one of the 60 most popular networks in the United States, I don't think you really have much in terms of consumer value. So that's a problem. Yeah. We don't have that problem.
There's a rethink there in that future, that mm-hmm. company's future. Speaking of the future, let's talk about where you go from here.
I'm here.
Your name has been floated as a possible candidate to succeed Jeff Bukas, who's the current CEO of Time Warner. So that's one possibility. Also, your name has
been
floated.
You want to put in a good word for me?
Jeff? Your name has also been floated as a possible COO candidate of Uber.
I saw that. I'm laughing because to poke fun at myself, I don't even know how to order an Uber.
What?
This is a true story. It's just, I'm not afraid to make fun of myself. I downloaded the app and I inadvertently signed up to be an Uber driver. True story. So I kept getting these messages from them saying that I hadn't passed whatever class or like benchmark level skills necessary in order to be an Uber driver. And I'm like, what the hell are they doing? And it only, I'm not going anywhere.
So probably not COO tomorrow, but is that an assignment that would excite you? A company that's kind of at a moment where it's certainly hitting its heyday, it's got a lot of attention, both positive and negative.
Right.
Is that something that would excite you?
I'm staying put, mm-hmm. Unless they don't want me. And I mean that. I've had an incredible career at Time Warner. I love working with my Turner colleagues. I'm really looking forward to the promise of what an AT&T Time Warner could mean. I think there's a lot of things that I could be helpful to contribute to make the company successful. Mm-hmm. And that would give me a lot of satisfaction. And whether that means I get a promotion or not, I've already got a full life and an incredibly exciting job. I do think, just as a quick aside though, I mean, I've got an unbelievable amount of respect for Uber. I'm not gonna go work there, but I've got an unbelievable amount of respect, and it's just a great example of an entrepreneurial story and just thinking out of the box in terms of how technology can like transform people's lives. Mm-hmm. It has completely screwed up the traffic infrastructure in Manhattan.
Yes.
Because you can't go on a street without there being 27 Ubers. So
everyone's double parked all the time.
We'd like Mayor de Blasio to look into that, but other than that.
Well, I mean, I'm glad you bring that up in terms of how technology transforms people's lives. What has surprised you the most about how technology is folded into media and vice versa?
Well, I think, one of the things that I think is going to be the most one of the most exciting areas of growth in media is going to be mobile. And
how much programming do you watch on your phone?
More and more. That's what's interesting, because 5 years ago, I would have said I would never watch a full-length anything mm-hmm. on my iPhone. Now I do. And I think and we see it in our own consumption of our own products and services, whether it's in kids, sports, where March Madness, the amount of mobile viewing is going up dramatically. Mm-hmm. And then at CNN, where mobile viewing, particularly on weekends when people are not in their offices and that they're not on desktops, mobile viewing is growing like a weed. And I think that's an area where we as media companies and Turner in particular, we need to think more about programming specifically for the device. In other words, and Jeff Zucker and I talk about this all the time, it's not CNN TV and CNN Digital, it's a CNN brand that is expressed differently to optimize itself on various devices. So we have dedicated people that work on Snapchat. dedicated people that work on Instagram, dedicated people that are working on the app. And we need that internal expertise, because the way my daughter is consuming CNN on Snapchat is not the same way that someone is on CNN.com. So I think that's one of the things that has surprised me the most, because I thought mobile video viewing, particularly on smaller devices, would be much more niche, and it's not.
So does that mean advertising rates for ads on mobile devices, on iPads, on screens, will start to catch up with that of TV? That hasn't happened yet, right?
No, it hasn't happened. I think advertising dollars usually lags usage.
By how long?
That's a good question. It depends. I think to the comment that you made a little bit earlier regarding, and this is supposed, because again, I'm not commenting on this, but the advertiser reaction to what happened at Fox News, mm-hmm. and how quickly it may or may not have happened, mm-hmm. I think the advertising community is beginning to move much faster and really wants to adapt to new technologies in ways, whereas in the past it was much slower. So mm-hmm. I don't know exactly when it catches up, but there's a huge gap right now between usage and monetization.
So there's an impetus on the advertisers' parts to be much more nimble and move quickly.
Yeah, well, they're going to want to be where the eyeballs are. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, and the elegance of advertising on mobile is getting much better. I mean, people are just getting much smarter in terms of how to show something. I mean, the idea, and I'm old, so I don't see that well, but a banner ad on an iOS device is impossible for me to read. But if you're scrolling through Instagram and you see like an elegant ad or an elegant ad that turns into video when you're scrolling past it, that could be in a very effective way to reach a large group of people.
What's the most memorable thing that you've seen on an iPhone or a small screen that
is that
resonates?
Like a trick question?
No. That resonates with you, where you're thinking, oh, this is great. If they could somehow scale this, or if they could do more of this, this would be huge. Just instances of it where you see flashes of brilliance from something experimental that's happening on a smaller screen, on a mobile device.
Look, I think, I could name a lot or a few. I mean, I think if you look at what we're doing with Cartoon Network.
We didn't rehearse this, by the way, so.
No, I know.
Yeah.
So Cartoon Network is doing a personalized network on mobile devices. Mm-hmm. So if you go to, My Cartoon Network or the Cartoon Network app, it's adaptive learning. And there's a bunch of machines in the background with algorithms that are understanding whether you like Teen Titans Go or We Bare Bears.
There's AI driving
yes.
Cartoon Network.
So I think AI on mobile devices is going to be transformative. And I think the other thing, which isn't necessarily on mobile devices, but the other thing that I think is going to be huge, which we're just barely scratching the surface on, is virtual reality. So I think augmented reality, virtual reality, and AI are three huge opportunities.
So talk a little bit more about virtual reality and augmented reality, because that it gets a lot of buzz, it gets a lot of press, but you don't really see people doing it and taking it up on a massive scale just yet.
But I think it's early days. I mean, these are not easy to do. We were
why
selling.
Why is it so hard to do?
I don't know. There's really smart people trying to figure out how to. I put on those virtual reality goggles. I'm like, there's some brilliant people who are doing this. Mm-hmm. We were selling virtual reality tickets to March Madness. So you could buy a virtual reality seat that puts you in this amazing seat, and you could watch the game from that vantage point. That's
how did it do?
I actually don't know. I'll get back to you on that.
Okay, putting you on the spot there. Go on.
I don't want to bullshit.
No. But that was something experimental.
No, but just, totally experimental. Uh-huh. But I've seen so many virtual reality demos, whether it's Cartoon Network gaming, or sports, or one of the most interesting or gaming itself. I was in a I was actually in an esports virtual reality where I wasn't actually playing the game, but I was following a player who was.
Okay.
So my son, there's one of the teams has a player named Taco. True story. He's like a 19-year-old kid who wears a ski hat like over his eyes, like up to here.
Uh-huh.
And my kid really likes this athlete, this e-athlete.
Uh-huh.
So you could possibly put on virtual reality goggles and not play the game, but you could follow Taco everywhere where he's going.
And experience it with him.
And one of the most crazy experiences that I've had in virtual reality was when I got dropped off in a street in Afghanistan with a CNN international correspondent. Mm-hmm. Just the experience, it sort of...
Was it frightening?
In ways. I mean, I don't think it's going to be applicable to every single application of media, but I was never that high on 3D. I always thought it was a bit of, especially for TV, I didn't think people were really going to be that interested in it. But virtual reality will be a game changer.
So how do we make sure, or how does the industry make sure that virtual reality doesn't go the way of 3D TV, which got a lot of buzz but ended up being kind of eh?
Well, I think at the end of the day, it's about the experience. And so we're developing applications that are specifically for virtual reality. And I mean, I don't know, as a parent, I worry that I'm going to screw up my kids, like, because you don't know what it's doing to their brain. But other than that, I think it's going to be great. But I look at virtual reality in some respects as the evolution from narrowband to broadband.
Hmm.
And I worked at AOL Time Warner at the time, and I remember that there were many people within the company that thought that broadband was merely an enhanced speed of narrowband. And I was sitting there saying, this feels like something fundamentally different. And I think virtual reality, while it may be more narrow because it'll be more applicable in certain areas than others, I think it's a game changer.
All right, final question to you before we open it up to the audience. What existential questions are you dealing with now that you thought was resolved maybe 2 years ago when it comes to your line of business?
These are not easy questions.
I know.
Existential questions.
About your line of business, about the prospects for your business?
I think with in our traditional business, with barriers to entry and distribution falling, mm-hmm. and more and more ways, my mother always taught me to be polite.
Well done.
More and more ways for people to consume media or video content or even, you know, Instagram, looking at pictures, it's all taking up people's time. And time is arguably, in some respects, people's most valuable asset. So I think for our brands, which are powerful, mm-hmm. at the same time, making sure that they stay relevant in a world where there's just going to be an explosion of availability of things for people to do, mm-hmm. I think it's the biggest single challenge that we have, which is why we're moving as quickly as we can to make sure that our traditional business brands stay strong, but at the same time, we're making huge investments in digital to increase our capabilities to get where our consumers are, and then over time, we need to build new businesses on top of that.
All right, so. The demands for time, it's coming from every direction.
Right.
Let's open things up to the audience. Sir, right in the front, do we have a microphone that we can pass over to our audience members? Gentleman with the blue shirt.
Hi, I've got questions on business models as they relate to the consumer value proposition. And I'm curious on your opinion on where this is going, because it seems to me the industry is stuck with a channel-based model that's totally obsolete. And you're charging either for fat bundles or skinny bundles or over-the-top channels, and people don't watch channels, they watch programs. So why can't I get something that packages whatever programs I want to watch at an appropriate discount level, not like a la carte at 99 cents or $5, you know, per show or per movie, but with a discount for some level of watching, some level of premium content that's calculated based on the mix that I do, and I don't have to pick my channels ahead of time. And it would let you sell your long tail channels to the people who want them and still monetize your fat head channels to
fat
the people who
channels.
Watch them. What?
Fat head, I like.
Well, I can talk to you later on specifically how to do that. But.
Okay. I was going to say, do you have a proposition? No, yes. I mean, look, I think it's a very, I appreciate the question. And this is something that we think a lot about. And our research today, this is today, I mean, the industry is obviously moving at a very rapid maybe not revolutionary, but a rapid evolutionary pace. Our research today continues to underscore that with the explosion of available shows, people need a discovery mechanism. And Netflix, one could argue, is nothing more than one Uber network. But when people, you know, if you ask somebody, well, what are you watching? A lot of times they won't say the name of the show. They'll say, I'm watching Netflix. At least that's what they say in my family. Or am I watching Game of Thrones or am I watching HBO? Today, on the most research that we recently received indicates that still networks dictate 50% of what determines a person's decision on a show to watch. So what we're trying to do is tighten the brand proposition of our network so that people will know, hey, if I go to TBS, this is the type of program that I'm likely to see, and there's a higher probability that I'm going to see something that I like, because almost from a recommendation engine standpoint, if I like, you know, if I like this show, I'm going to like that show. So I don't think we're close to getting to a point where we're going to disintermediate our networks and just start selling shows directly. But I mean, clearly we have to be, again, I'll go back to what I said a little bit earlier. We have to always try to put the company in a position where we can move as quickly as we can in whatever direction consumers want. It's one of the reasons why 3.5 years ago on TBS and TNT, Turner owned a very, very small percentage of the shows that it aired. Now, it's a much greater percentage. We're only airing shows other than sports that we own now. For precisely that reason, do we want to develop our own over-the-top services? Do we want to partner with others? Do we want to partner with HBO to create an entirely new service? Do we want to window our shows differently, sell an original show to another network or destination for first window rights? We'll take second window rights. I mean, everything is being thought of and on the table. And I appreciate the question. It's just not a simple answer.
And you also have control over where it's shown overseas as well.
Exactly. And that's the other thing, which is our international business is growing very, very quickly. And so their ability to distribute our original shows internationally has never been better.
Gentleman over there, raising his hand in the red turtleneck.
How you doing? What I want to know that do you guys plan to do something similar to like a Netflix? Because right now people don't want to be told when to watch a program. Mm-hmm. Now you know it's like everything is on the go. Mm-hmm. I watch most of my media on my phone. Mm-hmm. Or on my iPad because I can't be home at 8 or 9, or I wouldn't be able to be here. You see what I'm saying? So do you guys plan to take some of your content and put it in a model where you can pay $10 and watch all this original content and other content when we want it, how we want it, without any advertising?
Again, I appreciate the question. It's a similar answer. You know, I think I agree with you that fewer and fewer people are tolerant of previously determined schedules, right? And if you watch a show that you like and you watch an episode of that show, do I really want to wait another week to watch the second episode of that show, and I have no idea what channel it's on, what time it's on? And the answer is, I think consumers' tolerance for that is declining. So I think what it means for companies like us is we have to be more creative about how we package and present our shows to consumers. And we're trying to provide a grander rights grant to our cable satellite telco partners, and we call it stacking rights, which means that as shows air, they'll get stacked up on demand so that people can essentially replicate a binge view activity. So on one of our most popular TNT shows last year, we saw a huge spike in video on demand activity for episode 1 during the 8th week of the show. So to us, it means that people were actually going back and catching up, which is critically important, I think, as people are more and more becoming habituated to binge viewing on services such as Netflix. So it's a little tricky for us because we have agreements with cable satellite telco players where we can't just do anything we want with our programming. But I think more and more you're going to see us, we're going to have to be more innovative and creative to give customers the experience that they want. Otherwise, they're going to go somewhere else.
Gentleman in the back over there.
Hi, I'm Marcos with digital.nyc. Could you talk about in the VR space what you guys are doing with creating content that is intrinsically meant for VR versus having a linear narrative that you just put into a VR context? Yeah. Because they're different media.
Mm-hmm.
And what are you guys thinking about that? Because I have no doubt you are.
No, we are. And again, these are all hard questions.
I know. I told you.
Look, I think one of the areas where we're making specific VR content is in kids and games. And gaming could be a huge application. And so we're making meaningful investments there. And we're actually, for some of our shows, we're premiering episodes and formats before it even airs on the linear TV network. I think in other areas, I take your point, because we're still so early on in this area, I think we're doing a lot of linear extensions and experimentation. And I think this is a period of experimentation where we're going to be paying very close attention to what works versus what doesn't work. And so I think in some respects it might be, I don't want to say investment constraints, but our people are doing so many different things at the same time. I want to make sure that we're being smart about where we're placing our time and investments. But I appreciate the question.
The gentleman in the back, black sweater.
Thanks, Scarlett, very much. Appreciate that. Tony Sklar from Lima Charlie Tech. I want to talk about investment for a little bit. Is there anything that y'all are investing in, curating in technology that's going to help drive revenue? No.
The answer is yes.
Yes, you are.
Yeah. No, I mean, Mio, stand up. I mean, Mio Babbage runs iStream Planet. It's a fantastic company. Just one. Did what you just do, is that public or no?
Not yet.
Okay. Stay tuned.
Plus Madness is 34% increase, 98 million views, streams during the March Madness, huge mobile consumption.
Meal's business earns very significant amount of revenues. And a lot of what we're doing on the tech side is meant to sustain all of our other businesses. But there are opportunities which I'll actually, and I apologize for being a little opaque, we have some other ideas to create new business areas that are just, we're not ready to talk about yet.
All right, final question. Gentleman in the front with the jacket.
Thank you, Scarlett and John, for being here. It's a very interesting conversation, and Bloomberg for sponsoring this. My question to John is, what's it like sitting in your namesake's shoes?
Ted.
And how is he, by the way?
Ted's great. I'm presenting an award to him because he wins awards every month. I'm going down to Atlanta next week to present him with an award. It actually, in many respects, it's first of all, it's an honor and a privilege. You can't be on the Atlanta campus without at least once a day somebody bringing up Ted or the spirit of Ted or the entrepreneurialism or the fearlessness and risk-taking of Ted. And it's an awesome responsibility because I don't want to screw up the company. And he personally, he's been so kind and so nice to me and supportive. It's really been an honor and a privilege. He's a very unique, one-of-a-kind person.
All right, on that note, thank you everyone for coming. And before we go, before you go, I want to bring up Stephen Girard of Cornell Tech, from Cornell Tech, to give us some closing statements.
Thank you, Scarlett. My name is Stephen Gerhard. I'm in the MBA program at Cornell Tech, and barring any disasters, we'll graduate this upcoming Memorial Day. I want to just start with thanking Bloomberg for putting on this speaker series and allowing us as students to be a part of it. I met John Martin today face-to-face, and these are the opportunities that make going to Cornell Tech the kind of experience that's very special and very different from a lot of MBA programs. And then, of course, thank John Martin for the very candid session tonight.
Well, thank you for having me.
We have a tradition at school where every time we have a guest speaker, the students go around and give takeaways for the session that they had. So I want to give kind of my big takeaway that I got out of this evening was the idea of fans. So you're not talking about TV viewers versus Snapchat watchers or news on CNN or cartoons on Cartoon Network. You're talking about fans. And I think that is like a organizational ethos, that decisions are made based on that little thing, is very powerful stuff. That was kind of the part that resonated the most with me. And as a closing spot, Cornell Tech is moving out of the Google building this year, and we'll start next fall on Roosevelt Island. A lot of really exciting technology products and projects going on there. And we encourage you to check us out on CornellTech.com. Thank you.